Welcome to this week's Faith and Friends. We're looking forward to spending the next 30 minutes with you. We've made it past the daylight savings time change. At least, I think we've adjusted. You've adjusted?
I never really have much of an issue.
Well, we've now made it to the season of spring, so that is a good thing. Things are only looking up from here. Daylight savings time, spring is here.
Rain, lots and lots of rain, mud.
We should build a dome.
We should be positive. 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 Rain is good. Rain is important. Rain is needed.
Thank you, Farmer Jen.
All right. Rain, flowers, all kinds of great things to celebrate, as March 20th is not just the first official day of spring, but it's also the International Day of Happiness.
Wow.
It is.
Hold on. When's the American Day of Happiness? I don't want any of this international stuff. Let's make America happy again.
Oh, goodness gracious. All right, well, guess what? If you live in America, you qualify for international holidays. So, but Deb, what constitutes being happy?
So, do we get off of work that day?
Make some people happy.
That's true. Well, WalletHub.com claims that researchers have found the happiest cities in America. They consider mental state, fitness, social satisfaction, and financial well-being as the keys to happiness, with wealth being the top key.
Does this go along with America's friendliest city? Because we know where that is.
That's not far from us. It's in our viewing area. Some of you are watching us from America's friendliest city.
And there's signs all around town. So it is the friendliest in Delphus.
I thought it was Findlay.
No.
No, that's Flag City. Findlay is Flag City. That's right. All right, well, we can give more comments on this in a bit, but let's take a look at the findings ranking what Wallet Hub considers to be. They looked at the top 150 cities in America, and here is what they consider.
I hope Bonsville made this list.
Well, I don't know if they quite went that far down considering the per capita happiness. I'm sure Bonsville's up there high.
Okay.
But coming in at the top, Fremont, California. Not Fremont, Ohio, but Fremont, California. California has the top four spots. San Jose is number two, Irvine number three, San Francisco ranking the fourth happiest place to live. Now for Ohio cities, well, several did fall in that top 150. Columbus comes in the highest of the Ohio cities at 95th, Cincinnati 136th, Akron 140, Toledo 146th, and then Cleveland is 149th, and Detroit, Michigan 150th. That's some interesting findings there.
It's not meaning 150th is the top. That's the opposite. But you know, it causes me to stop think.
Hold on a second. I don't want to get too much in the methodology here. So they're saying Detroit is the very worst city out of 150. So they didn't rank any other cities underneath 100. There's not 151st?
Well, and by the way, just so you know, last week they came out with America's healthiest cities, and Detroit came in last in that one, too.
I can understand that. There's certainly some issues with Detroit, with socioeconomic things that we really don't have the time to go into at this point. But happiness is fleeting.
Yes.
I think we can all agree to that happiness is fleeting, but it's also an attitude thing. And I would say that it's more important to be content than it is to be happy.
Yes, absolutely. Because wherever God has called us to be, that is where we are to be. And I think we can find contentment and even happiness in any of those places.
That's right. And let's dive right into our scripture that doesn't include the word happiness. In fact, it isn't even found in the King James Version of the Bible, the word happiness. But Psalm 37, 3-6 does talk about finding delight. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on His faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and He shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in Him, and He shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as the light, and your justice as the noonday. That is where we need to find our satisfaction, and our contentment is in the Lord.
Important to use those words, I think, because if we're focusing on happiness, then we're always going to be disappointed in the end. Happiness is fleeting, like you said.
Well, and Paul talked about in the New Testament that he strives to find contentment, that that is what we need to do, is to be content in all situations, that through our deep relationship with the Lord, we can be content regardless of where we find ourselves in, that contentment is certainly important.
Well, contentment, satisfaction, and happy. Those were without a doubt many of the positive emotions taking place at St. James Church earlier this month. What started as a prayer point during a walk through a South Lima neighborhood is now a beacon of light, proclaiming the saving message of Jesus Christ. It took 5 long years of work, prayer, and too many roadblocks, but St. James Baptist Church is officially open for business. God's business, that is. March 5th, 2017, a day marked in history for this small church on the corner of Franklin and Harrison Streets in Lima. Not only was it packed full with community members desiring to praise God for all he has done and all he plans to do, but what you see today is proof that when God sets out on a project, nothing is going to get in the way from its completion.
The way we found the church was on a prayer walk that was led by Pastor Baker, and it was his vision at first is that, maybe we should bring a church into this community.
Originally founded as a church in the late 1940s, the structure had closed years ago, resulting in years of vacancy and structure wear. But for Pastor Jim Baker, a spark started inside of not just him, but other members of the Men of Faith group, that God could relight this community lighthouse and reclaim this corner as an open door for the gospel.
We found Sister Edwina Johnson, who was the reigning and seemed like the sole reigning trustee for this particular building. And go figure. And we found her in Lima Towers, and we went to visit with her. She was such a wonderful and sweet person. She was so, you know, godlike. Her spirit was so godlike. And she was happy to hear that there is somebody that wanted to invest in the building.
Fast forward 5 years. 5 years of volunteer work on walls, electrical, foundational structure, and so much more. 5 years of prayers, roadblocks, and believing to continue going despite moments that seemed hopeless. 5 years of pushing through with belief that God had a plan for not just this building, but its impact on this neighborhood. That's what landed us to March 5th, 2017, the day this church reopened for God's business in the area.
In some way, this neighborhood has become suppressed and also depressed, you know, in darkness. We want to bring God's light back into this community. Most people that passed the church when we were working on it indicated is that when that church was open, is that this community was much better than what it is now. Not that we have bad folks here, but I think when the church closed, is that a lot of hope left from this community. And I think that now that the church is open, is that I think hope is going to be brought back to this community again.
The inaugural service saw individuals from all over the region joining together to celebrate. Area pastors, government office holders, community members, and members of the Lima Men of Faith joined together in song and prayer, sending a message to this neighborhood that it is important. The people here matter, and there is hope. The church will be led by Pastor Levi Collins. After traveling for 22 years from Lima to Paulding County to serve as pastor at Zion Baptist Church in Laddie, Pastor Collins and his wife are eager to make their own home neighborhood their core ministry focus.
We look forward to seeing people in the community here. I'm going to be knocking on doors across the week, reminding people that, sure, we are open, and we want you to come out, and we want you to be with us. And we're going to, you know, we are going to try and get this community motivated with the Word of God. And we want them to be just as excited as we are that God has come to town.
St. James Baptist Church is now holding weekly Sunday services, Sunday school at 10 o'clock in the morning with morning worship following at 11. St. James is located 800 East Franklin Street in Lima.
Well, dozens of members of the Lima community gathered Tuesday, March 14th for the second citywide prayer event organized by Ann Miles, Todd Gordon, and Jason Harris. Now, this year's event gathered like-minded believers inside the Lima Senior High School auditorium, where 20 individuals took the time to pray for specific areas that have direct effect on the city of Lima: drug addictions, the future of our youth, mentoring, sex trafficking, education, city and county government, and more. Now, amens and applause often came from the audience as those in attendance vocally agreed with the cries of those on stage. Prayer event was not just about an event about unity, but it's about a group of people coming together to ask God to be Lord over the city of Lima.
Very touching there. Well, this week's Faith on the Field feature comes from Minster High School. Northwest District Basketball Player of the Year, Rosie Westerbeck, had a great season on the basketball court, but she's showing how her passions branch much further than just playing sports. Rosie teamed with the Cincinnati Reds for her Red Wagon campaign, collecting and distributing toys to kids at Dayton Children's Hospital.
The reason I created this was when I was younger, I was in the hospital at Dayton Children's, And I just remember the care that they gave me there was phenomenal. It just made me feel at home and comfortable, because being in there as a kid is super scary. You don't know what's going on. Youth Leadership Association, we did the Red Wagon campaign again, and we got 14 Red Wagons, and the entire town helped us fill it up, and we donated thousands of toys to the kids there, and we actually arranged for the Reds to come along with us. The Reds caravan overlapped the exact same day we were going to visit the kids, so I asked them if they would accompany us, and they willingly did, and it's actually going to become part of their Reds caravan visit every year.
Rosie gives a lot. You know, she tries to give as much as she can to others, give of herself. And that idea is tremendous in the effort that she has, you know, again, tried to give to other people. You know, she's not all about herself.
Usually I'm the one being right involved visiting with the kids, but it was super neat to be a part of an experience where I got to kind of play the background and see the other people being able to interact with the kids and seeing how they talk to them and what questions they ask them and how they connected with them. Because it's, you know, it's a little bit difficult. You don't know really what to say to the kids when they're in the hospital, but all you can be is encouraging, and it was cool to see other people and how they were encouraging to them and kind of see it from the background.
And the seniors always encouraging on the court as well.
Rosie has been a huge influence in what we do on the basketball floor. Obviously, ball handling, scoring, the defense that she brings to the floor. The biggest thing is the energy. You know, the rest of the team feeds off of it. You know, they feed off some of a lot of the other girls. And the idea of being able to create energy when Minster needs it the most, defensively especially. Our defense creates our offense, and that's what we preach.
But recently a hand injury has hampered all that Westerbeck is used to being able to do on the floor.
Patience. You know, it's difficult to experience an injury. It's really frustrating mentally and obviously physically, but through the journey, you know, a few weeks ago I realized, you know, an injury doesn't have to be the worst thing in the world. It, you know, it's a great opportunity for me to sit on the bench and to view the game from a different perspective. And that's definitely what God has taught me, you know, to value the injuries and value the troubles that you face.
Ottawa Glandorf High School champion swimmer Ben Seeltz has impressed many with his talents in the water, but how many also realize his high school senior is deaf, has been that way since birth? When he's not swimming, he wears cochlear implant, a device that allows a deaf person to hear. But for many, communication challenges still remain. Now, as Clark Powell shows us, researchers have launched a high-tech study to better understand a deaf child's learning process, which could not only help those children, but their parents as well.
Logan Lodge's parents were elated when a cochlear implant allowed their son to hear for the first time at 10 months old. But there were still challenges ahead to help Logan communicate on the same level as children with normal hearing.
We had never experienced communicating with a deaf person at all before our son was born. So it was interesting for us to learn how to communicate and how to teach Logan how to communicate with us.
Researcher Derek Houston says that's a common struggle for parents of deaf children. So to better understand how children with cochlear implants absorb information and learn new words, he designed a study at the Ohio State University Wexner Medical Center, which observes parent and child interactions from six different camera angles.
This is the Tima.
The parent presents toys with different names to their children, and every detail of how the child reacts is recorded.
To give even more detail about that, they're also wearing eye tracking devices.
Those devices help researchers understand what catches a child's attention during conversation and how parents might be able to use that information to better communicate.
The timing of when a parent says a label and what the child is doing when the label is said predicts whether or not the child will learn a word.
Logan's parents used what they're learning from the study to constantly reinforce language by doing things like narrating everyday activities. And their hard work is paying off.
Honestly, there are many times throughout the day that I forget that he's deaf at all, which is just incredible.
At Ohio State Wexner Medical Center, this is Clark Powell reporting.
The 2017 Faith Challenge continues our 12-step spiritual workout. We started the year focusing on daily Bible reading and daily prayer. And then we moved into the importance of repenting, coming before our Heavenly Father and recognizing, you know, we are sinners. We have screwed up some things we know we've done, some things we haven't known, we don't know that we've done, but God can forgive them all. But once we get to that point, then there's a next step, another step of forgiveness, and that is a step of forgiving ourselves, which many times can be one of the most difficult things for us personally to do. Pastor Neil Whitney from the church at Allentown joins me today to talk about that important step of forgiveness. First, forgiving ourselves. Good morning. Hello, Neil. Thank you for being with us.
Well, good morning. It's great to be here. I don't know about you, but I've made a mistake or two in my life, and I've been guilty. And I've discovered that it's hardest to forgive me because I really know how guilty I am. I realize how much I've failed God in the process. And then the Bible says the battle's not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. So then the devil steps in and keeps reminding me of how guilty I am. So then it becomes a battle, a big battle.
Yeah, that pesky devil who does not want to see us move forward. But God has forgiven us. We truly are supposed to have freedom in Christ. Are there any things that a person can do to help fight that battle and get move forward with self-forgiveness?
Well, the number one thing for me is to recognize that what Jesus did on the cross for me is a reality in my life today. And that's probably the hardest thing to remember, is that God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, 1 John 1:9. And I have to constantly remind myself that that's true. And the devil doesn't want me to believe that. He would rather that I would buy the lie that I'm still guilty.
For those of you at home who are thinking possibly about things that are going on in your life, maybe you are recognizing that there's some areas that you've allowed the guilt to overtake you and you're in those chains, I want you to stop and think about that. You truly are a child of God.
Amen.
And the day that Jesus died on the cross, even though it was 2,000 plus years ago, it was done for you. It was a one-time sacrifice that doesn't ever expire. And for anything you have done in your life, whether it was yesterday, last week, or 25 years ago, that blood on the cross, that sacrifice covered it. And so today could be an opportunity for you to just start proclaiming that. Proclaiming, yes, I am a child of God. Jesus died for me, and Satan, you cannot continue to have power over me. I will move forward in that victory of forgiveness. Forgiveness is an incredible thing. I mean, where would any of us be without forgiveness?
We would be toast. The big thing about Jesus dying on the cross, I ask a lot of people in the process of sharing faith and growing, we need to understand that if we'd been the only person on the face of the earth, Jesus would have died on the cross for us. And that's huge, to accept that personal sacrifice for us. It's how much God loves us that he would send Jesus to die just for one person, and that person is me, and that person is you, and that person is anyone who is listening.
So we're about out of time, but how about for the person who is really serious about this, really does want to move forward? Maybe there has been some habitual sins, or maybe there's been issues that is, you know, the shame is so great. They're serious, they're moving on, 2 weeks from now they mess up again. Have they blown it? Is it too late now?
It's never too late. Just time to start over. God will forgive you as many times as is necessary, as long as your heart is right. An accountability partner is the answer to that question. Mm. James, it says, confess your sins one to the other,
yes,
that you might be healed. So that's a huge key, that second. So believe you have the power of God within you, and believe that same power resides in another person that can walk alongside you to help you have the victory that God wants you to have and the freedom that you mentioned earlier.
And that accountability partner, that's really important. Now, I know there's a lot of churches within our viewing area, a lot of great ones, but is there anything that your church offers or any services you know of? If someone's saying, hey, I got to figure out how to do that. I got to find the accountability partner. I got to find the group. I am ready to move forward.
Any church that operates in the realm of Celebrate Recovery can help you with that, and there's a lot of those in Lima now. So any Celebrate Recovery church is a great place to start. But I'm sure almost every church has an accountability mechanism in one way or another.
All right, accountability, forgiveness, moving forward, freedom in Jesus Christ. These are all things that are available to you no matter what's happened in your life. Today is the end of the shame game.
Amen.
It's all gone. Don't allow yourself to live in that anymore. If you happen to be watching me in a dark room with your, you know, get some sunlight in there, get yourself out in the open area. Don't just feel the sun, S-U-N, feel the sun, S-O-N, because Jesus did die on the cross for you. That means he has forgiven you.
Amen.
And he wants you also to forgive yourself.
The Converge Youth Conference for 8th through 12th graders is literally days away. This year's event speakers are brand new to Converge. It's Ben Stewart and Chip Dean. They're excited to share encouragement and insight designed to challenge the attendees to truly choose a life, to live a life for Jesus. Here's a look at what attendees can expect from Chip Dean, who serves as the global student pastor at Liberty Baptist Church in Hampton Roads, Virginia.
What does the providence of God mean? Well, write this down with me. Here's what the providence of God means. The doctrine of providence is God's perfect power. It's God's perfect power over everything for the purpose of Jesus. The doctrine of providence is God's perfect power over everything for the person of Jesus. That is a definition you need to remember. Because you need to remember, as things happen in life that are very difficult, and they're very hard to go through, and they're very tough to understand, that God is practicing his perfect power in your life, ultimately for the purpose of Jesus. So tonight we are going to ask a lot of questions, and the first question we're going to start off with is this: why does evil exist if God is good? You ever wondered that? Why does evil exist if God is good? Now think about this with me. If God is good, that means that he hates bad. And if God is good and he hates bad, which means he hates sin, and at the same time, think about it, God is also all-powerful. So not only does God hate sin, but he's also all-powerful over sin. So if God hates sin and he's all-powerful over sin, then why does he allow it? If he doesn't like it, and if he could stop it, then why does God allow sin to actually even happen? Why does God allow sin in your life? Why does God allow sin done to you? Why does God allow sin done by you, right? Why does God allow sin? So look with me at Genesis chapter 3. Look at Genesis chapter 3. You should have already been turned there, so you should be good to go. And Genesis 3 shows us when sin first shows up on the scene. Look at Genesis 3 verse 1. It says this. It says, "Now the serpent," meaning Satan, "was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, 'Did God actually say you shall not eat of the tree in the garden?' And the woman said to the serpent, 'Well, we may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, or you will die.' But the serpent said to the woman," listen, you will not surely die, "for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will actually be like God, knowing between good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was a delight to the eyes and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate." Why, if God hates sin, if God hates Satan, if God is powerful over everything that is evil, why would God even have created an angel who could become Satan? Why would God have allowed the serpent to even go into the garden? Why would God have even created a tree where they could have eaten from for them to become evil instead of good? Why would God allow these things to happen? Now, let me help answer that question for you, because if you were not asking that question before, you probably are now. Some of you might even be doubting your faith. I don't know, right? Like, am I really saved? Is there really a God? What's going on right now? Right? So let's answer this question. Here's the deal. God is always working towards an eternal end, which is the glory of Jesus. He's always working towards this way. And think about this. God is God. Which means because he is God, God can only do what is absolutely right and what is absolutely best, and the absolute ultimate thing to do can only be done by God. So everything that happens is God's ultimate plan as he allows it and he moves this time and to keep going. So why would God allow sin to come on the scene, and how could that be a part of God's plan as he has allowed it to happen? Well, think about it. If God had not allowed sin, there would be so much that we would not know about God.
More from Chip Dean and many others at this year's Converge conference. Do you know someone who should attend but can't afford to go to Converge? TV 44 is giving away tickets. Registration deadline Monday, March the 27th, and it's easy to register. Just visit faithandfriends.wtlw.com, click on the contest link, fill out the form, and press enter. Be sure to include a valid email address and phone number so we can let you know if you win.
That's right.
We won't let you know if you lose. Only if you win. Or do you let people know when they lose?
I typically don't take the time to let them know. I'm assuming that
they're not losers, they just didn't win. Let's be kinder and gentler.
We love you.
We don't have participation ribbons for you though, I'm sorry.
Okay. But you can save the email and frame it and print it out, and you can maybe get a nice seal put on that.
We have finally made it to the season of spring, even though it felt more like spring in February than it has in March. The calendar now tells us that we are into the second season of the year, and here at TV 44, that also means the Spring to Life campaign.
Between now and Mother's Day, we have a goal to raise $70,000 to spring us forward with our operating budget. We know that TV shows like Joyce Meyer, David Jeremiah, and even shows like this one, Faith and Friends, are impacting to not just you, but to many throughout the region. Now, as TV 44 prepares to celebrate its 35th year of broadcasting, we are so thankful for those 35 years of broadcasting the message of Jesus Christ throughout the region. We're thankful that God continues to find ways to sustain this ministry.
We're thankful for those who have already supported us this month. Our campaign started in March, and we've already had some donations already come in.
Thank you so much, Violet from Columbus Grove, for your gift. We also want to thank Jerry from Lima. Thank you so much for being a part our team here at TV 44.
Mary from Lima, thank you very much for your gift. Ron from Vaughnsville. He didn't want to just say Columbus Grove. He wanted to make sure Vaughnsville.
Because it is one of the happiest cities.
Absolutely.
Obviously.
Happiest soft spot in our heart for Vaughnsville and West Lipsick and Mandale and all those little hamlets throughout Central Ohio.
Well, every donation made in the months of March, April, and through Mother's Day will be designated toward the Spring to Life campaign so we can spread that life-changing message to every large city and every small hamlet. Every single one is the same in God's eyes. You can also make a pledge and choose to pay monthly in installments. Additionally, be watching for special thank you gifts, courtesy of many of the preachers and teachers you enjoy on this station. Just watch your favorite programs here on TV 44 and you'll have a chance to learn more about that.
Donating safe and secure, just visit us online at WTLW.com, call 419-339-4444, or you can visit or write us at 1844 Beatty Road, right here in Lima, 45807.
Well, before we leave, a reminder about the 2017 Faith Challenge, forgiving yourselves. What are you holding on to that God wants you to release? We encourage you to take some time and ask yourself that question, and then be ready to take the steps toward that self-forgiveness. There is an enemy prowling you like a lion who wants you to stay locked in that world of self-shame and guilt. But Jesus came to overcome the world. And now one final look at our verse.
Psalm 37, verses 3 through 6. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord. He shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday. A lot of action words there, promises the Lord will do for us, and action steps for us to take in our relationship with the Lord as well. Dwell on that here today and the rest of this week. Have a good one.